Hello everyone, today is 20th of July. My name is Sahil and welcome to the newspaper analysis. Guys, today we will be taking up the complete coverage of the Hindu newspaper and some of the attachments from the Mint also we will be taking up. Now guys, if you are liking our initiative, please do like our video. Now, first of all, let's take the overview of the entire newspaper. So this is the page number one of the Hindu, and here we can see that the Pegasus spyware has mentioned, and the entire process of the Pegasus, how it infest, etc., has been discussed. We will be taking it up. Then guys, we see that the other issues are there, which is not very much important with respect to the UPSC. Now guys, moving to the next page. So into the city page also, we can see that how the city of Delhi has been submerged due to the floods and due to the incessant rains which have been there. Not very much important. Now guys, we reach to the editorial page, and here we can see that editorial is talking about the fine balance that has been created by the Supreme Court between the fundamental right to health and life. We will see this thing. Then guys, this particular article talks about that how learning is being compromised because of the schools have been closed. Now guys, into this particular article, much of the substance is not there. Fine. But why? Because guys, this particular development is very much evolving as the government's unlock process will be changing. Such kind of things will be changing. Then guys, this particular article talks about the Egypt's evolution or Egypt's development into the West Asia. So we will see this. Then guys, this particular article is talking about the surveillance reform. So we will see what it is. Then guys, this particular article talks that how India can be made as a sporting nation. We will see what is there. Then guys, making police more humane. So police reforms have been discussed. We will again be seeing it. Then guys, this particular article, here much of the political news has been there, but this particular article is talking about the labor conference. So we will see that what labor conference is, and all the issues into this respect will be taken up. Then guys, further moving. Now here, onto this particular page guys, we can see that basically the surveillance which has been there, it has been questioned into the parliament, and disruptions have been there. So guys, some of this particular development we will be seeing into a comprehensive picture along with the editorial. Then guys, here we can see that protecting children is a priority. So the center government's initiatives into this direction we will be taking up. Then guys, here we can see that the speedy trial is a fundamental right as said by Bombay High Court. We'll see what has happened. Then guys, it is talking about the new Oxfam report onto the inequality 2021. We will see this thing. Then guys, here guys, we can see nothing much important is there. Much of the evolving issues are there. We see into the Afghanistan, Taliban is becoming very much offensive. So such kind of things are there. Then guys, on to the business page. Just here we can see that India is on a course onto the economic growth. So some of the observations are there which we will be seeing it up. So guys, this was the overview of the entire newspaper, and now let's take these articles one by one in detail. Now friends, starting up today's newspaper analysis with the GS quote. So today we will be taking a quote from the Potter Stewart, who was the justice at the US Supreme Court. He says that censorship reflects a society's lack of confidence in itself. Guys, nowadays we see that the censorship into the myriad forms is being imposed onto the medias, onto the activists, onto the journalists. And basically, it is a kind of a depiction that the state is not having the trust in its own capabilities, into its own social justice measures. And so that nobody else unearths such kind of deficiencies, the state is imposing the censorship. Now guys, rather than going for the censorship, state needs to enhance the social justice, state needs to enhance rather the fundamental freedoms that are to be given to the citizen. So guys, into this particular capacity, we can utilize that how censorship is problematic. And guys, this particular quote can be utilized into the answers related to the GS paper number 2. So that is all about the today's GS quote. And now let's take the newspaper analysis one by one. Now guys, taking up the first news article. So it has been taken up from the Mint newspaper, as well as here the articles from the Hindu newspaper have also been clubbed. Now guys, this particular article is talking about the Pegasus software, Pegasus spyware. Now the Pegasus has been into the news from so many days. Even yesterday we have taken up this, but guys, now this particular issue had flared up so much, so little bit more deeper into this Pegasus spyware we will be going, and it will be important for GS paper number 3 as well as for GS paper number 2. Now guys, when we talk about the Pegasus, what has happened recently, the Pegasus project was unveiled, and into this Pegasus project, worldwide media houses, they collaborated, and it was found out that around the world, countries are using the Pegasus to spy onto the journalist, onto the activist, onto the dissidents, onto the people from the opposition party. No, guys, all these particular things, the implicative part, we will be looking into one of the editorial. Now here, let's see briefly about the Pegasus. So guys, the Pegasus, it is also called as the Q suit, and it has been designed, it has been launched, and it is usually provided by the NSO firm, which is an Israeli cyber company. Now guys, the NSO, which is an Israeli corporation, first of all says that we provide this particular spyware only to the governments. We don't provide it to the private individuals. Now into the India, it has been found that many of the journalists are being spied by the Pegasus. So basically an indirect hint goes that the government might had commissioned that particular snooping. Now though there is nothing concrete into this particular direction, but a guys, a kind of inference is being drawn. Now guys, when we talk about the Pegasus or the Q suit, as also it is known as, so basically as early as 2016, it was found out that such kind of software or spyware is existing, which can exploit the vulnerabilities of the mobile phone, both the iOS as well as the Android mobile phones. Now guys, when we talk about the Pegasus, till 2018, the Pegasus was infecting the people's mobile phone, and it relied onto the SMS or the WhatsApp messages. So guys, these SMS or WhatsApp messages were sent to the end users, and they used to trick the users that they click onto a particular link, and when they will be clicking, they will be directed onto a website, and that and then the website within the milliseconds will identify the operating system that is being used into the mobile phone, and will send the spyware which will be infecting. And guys, into this, the user will not be knowing that something has happened. However, after this particular thing, recently the NSO had upgraded the Pegasus, and it has been provided that by the Amnesty in 2019, they had started to use the network injections. Now, what are the network injections? No guys, the network injections is actually a way by which the Pegasus is infecting the mobile phones without even user doing any particular thing. See, into your mobile phone, there are many of the applications, and in these applications, many a time, many of the bugs are there. So these vulnerabilities are exploited by the Pegasus. Now guys, it has been provided that now the Pegasus had achieved the zero click installations. Now the zero click installations means that by the network injection, it will be infested into your mobile, you will not do anything, and neither you will be knowing that your mobile has been infested. Guys, many a times what happened, simply a WhatsApp call is made onto your mobile phone, a missed call actually is made onto your mobile phone, and by that missed call, the spyware gets infiltrated into your mobile phone, and then this spyware will even delete the call logs, so you don't know that even such kind of WhatsApp missed call has came onto your mobile number. So the zero click installations have been achieved, and by this the user never comes to know about this thing. Then guys, it has been provided that once this particular spyware enters your device, it installs a module to track all the call logs. It can read the messages, emails, calendars, internet history. It can gather the location that where a person right now is and send all this information to the attacker. Now guys, this particular thing becomes problematic because first of all, this Pegasus is causing the cyber violence because all this information is being taken up. Then guys, the physical violence have also been connected with the cyber violence into the Europe. Why? Because some of the activists, by tracking their location, they have physically been attacked also into the US. So there are both aspects to this. Then guys, it has been provided that it can also be installed manually on a device over a wireless transceiver. So both the options are there. And guys, it has been provided that if it fails to connect with the command server for the period of more than 60 days, then it has a capability that it can self-destruct itself, and all the traces will also be erased. You will never be knowing that sometime it was present into this particular mobile phone. After that guys, it has also been provided that if it is detected that the spyware has been installed on some of the wrong device, it can self-destruct itself. Moreover, the Amnesty International has noted that despite of many of the corrective patches that have been issued by the iOS as well as Android, much effective thing has not happened. Moreover guys, it has also been provided that in order to stay safe, first of all, you should not click on any of the suspicious links or such kind of things. But even that thing doesn't matter because now, because of this zero click installations, it can be infested onto the any mobile phones. Now guys, there are some of the factors. Number one, the NSO says that it sells it only to the government, so it basically points out that government might be using it for the surveillance. Secondly, Commonly, it is said that, guys, there was a report published in 2016 which said that to invest just 10 mobile phones, more than $1 million is needed. Now, this particular capacity, this financial capacity cannot be there with the ordinary hackers or the ordinary, ordinary cyber breaching groups. Such kind of capabilities can be there only with the state. So, because of this particular thing, this Pegasus has drawn a flak from large number of opposition parties, media houses. And guys, we can see that many of the high profile people such as Rahul Gandhi, Prashant Kishore, ex-election commissioner, they have been targeted by this Pegasus. So guys, that is all that how this particular malware is working, and it might have a large implications onto the privacy of the individuals, as well as the snooping already has been a very big problematic thing. So that is all about this particular Pegasus. I hope you have understood it, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this article here, we have again taken up one article from the Hindu newspaper and other connected newspaper attachments from the other parts of the Hindu, and again this particular surveillance aspect is being talked about. But into this article, rather than the technicalities of the Pegasus, we will see that how actually the implication onto the rights is coming because of this surveillance. So guys, already we discussed the Pegasus project, which is a kind of a collaborative investigation by journalists around the world. Now when we talk about the Pegasus attacks onto the journalist activist on into the India, it has been found that in 2019 also the allegations were made that the Pegasus attack have been made onto the journalist as well as onto the human right activist into the Maharashtra and Chhattisgarh, because guys, there was the Bhima Koregaon incident, and as the part of the Bhima Koregaon incident, some of the journalists were being spied out. Now guys, even so allegations were made, nothing concrete has been come out. The investigative agencies have not actually completely ruled that such thing has either happened or not. Then it has been provided that, guys, when we talk about the India's ranking onto the World Press Freedom Index, which is published by the Reporters Without Borders, then guys, it has been said that in 2021, India had ranked 142 out of 180 countries. So already our track record with respect to giving freedom to the journalists have not been good. Moreover, guys, when we talk about the journalist, they enjoy a fundamental right to press, which is specifically provided under the article number 19. Moreover, guys, the media, we call it as the fourth pillar of the democracy, and therefore the journalists who are brave, the journalists who are reporting the news with the facts, they need to be protected, and such kind of surveillance might reduce the morale of the free reporting in India, and it might be a blow onto the democratic ethos in India. Now guys, when we talk about the surveillance in India, the government gets the power of surveillance under the following acts, which we will be discussing now one by one. Number one is the Telegraph Act. Now under the Telegraph Act, onto the telephone conversations, the government can carry the surveillance. Then guys, there is the IT Act of 2000, and IT Act provides that on all the medias which are being carried through the internet, government can carry the surveillance. There is specifically the section 69 of the IT Act, as well as the Interception Rules of 2009, which provides the scope for the surveillance. But the problem comes that they are very much vague. There are no clear grounds here, and even these interception rules of 2009, they are even more vaguer. So guys, here whether the state will be using it in order to use it as a last resort, it is a doubtful thing. Then further, it has been provided that, guys, even these kind of legislations are having the vague provisions, but in no case it is allowed that government can hack the mobile phone of any individual. Fine. So it, even the hacking has been made as a criminal offense under the IT Act. So guys, if such kind of hacking of the mobile phones which we are talking about, if the government role is there, then it will be actually a very sorry state of affairs. Then further, guys, it has been provided that as we talk about the Indian democracy, which follows the theory of separation of powers, into this executive is one of the wing, and executive needs to have the balanced power only. Now guys, what has happened, as the Pegasus is being used by the government agencies, or any kind of surveillance is being used by the government agencies, there might be a kind of a snooping onto the judiciary also. Into this particular capacity, the executive gets a far more power than the judiciary, than the legislature. And guys, into this capacity, the theory of separation of power is also based. Executive gets too much of power, and even the judiciary might not able able to control it. Then guys, it has been provided that as the individuals they are being spied upon, it will have a kind of a chilling effect onto the free speech, and the doctrine of chilling effect has well propounded into the India. So onto that ground also, it is not it cannot be allowed. Then guys, into the Puttaswamy case, the fundamental right to the privacy has been recognized under the article number 21. So there also such kind of activities cannot be sustained. Then guys, it has been provided that such kind of snooping or such kind of hacking of the mobile phones is also breaching the article number 32 and article number 226 of the Indian Constitution. Now under article number 32 and 226, you can approach the Supreme Court and the High Court respectively if your fundamental rights have been violated. Now guys, as if a mobile phone is being hacked, the fundamental right to privacy is being violated. But how the person can approach the Supreme Court or the High Court? Because he is not having any evidence to show that such kind of thing has happened. More or less, there could be the reports. But guys, concrete data, concrete fact, concrete evidence is very hard to find. So what has happened? Now guys, here we can see that this violation happens into the secret, and thus affected person is unable to show a breach of their rights, which is again a kind of a problematic thing. Now into this particular capacity guys, there are two things that are to be done. Number one, the state needs to have a kind of a moral responsibility on such kind of things, and into this capacity the accountability is needed to be furnished by the government whenever such kind of incidents are coming. So government needs to come out and needs to assure the citizens that how the government is steadfast on preserving the rights of citizens and it is not participating into such kind of things. And secondly, the judiciary also needs to be very much proactive to check such abuse of power by the state authorities. So this is the message that has been given into this particular article. So guys, that is all about this particular thing. I hope that you have formed the opinion. However guys, whenever you are writing on such kind of questions, or when you are, if you are supposed to be giving interview this particular year, if such kind of questions are coming, make sure that you are not directly targeting any of the government agency, but in a very subtle way you are delivering your messages. So that is all about this particular article, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article taken from the editorial section of the Hindu, and here we can see that just a small observation is there that Supreme Court has identified that the right to health and right to life is far more important than right to religious sentiments. Now see, when we talk about the right to life, it is provided as a part of our fundamental right, particularly under article number 21. Then guys, the right to religion has also been provided under the fundamental right, article number 25 to 28. Now what has happened, the pandemic is going on, and into the pandemic there are the requests that has come from the different quarters that they should be allowed to follow the celebrations onto the Bakrid, they should be allowed to go for the Kavad Yatra which happens during this particular time. And many other kind of religious congregations are also being asked from time to time. But at the same time, there is impending fear of the COVID-19's third wave also. So should we stop it? If we will stopping such kind of religious congregations, obviously the right to religion, right to practice religion will get impacted. However, on to the other hand, right to life will be conserved, because guys, then the super spreading events will not be there. But if we give this particular right to religion, then guys, the super spreading events might happen and that right to life will be violated. So what is the balance that is to be achieved? So guys, recently the Supreme Court had very clearly provided that the principle that the health of the public and their right to life are paramount. It has provided all other sentiments, albeit religious, are subservient to this most basic fundamental right. So the controversy has been settled and clear-cut directions have been given to the state governments that whatever religious congregations are under the way, they need to be stopped. The Kavad Yatra, etc., are needed to be stopped immediately. So this is the message that has been given into this particular article. Apart from this, nothing important is there. So that is all about this article, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article again taken from the Hindu newspaper, and it is talking about the police reforms. Now see, generally when we talk about the police reforms, we talk about bringing some kind of procedural reforms, we talk about bringing some legislative reforms and all such kind of things. Even guys, there is the 7 directives that have been given by the Supreme Court into the Prakash Singh case, and all these Prakash Singh cases, 7 directives are talking about that the political interference needs to be reduced, fine, there needs to be more accountability and all such kind of things. Now I am not deliberately going into the 7 directives of the Prakash Singh case because that is not the subject matter. Now, this article says that rather than working on to the legislative aspects, we need to work on a psychological aspect into the policing. Now, policing needs to be made more humane. Policing needs to be made more that they are imbibed or infused with the values of empathy, compassion, etc. Now, first of all, here some of the datas have been given. Guys, it has been provided that between April 1 and November 30, 2015, 25,357 cases were registered under the police category. Okay, so more than 25,000 violations by the police are there. And into that, guys, there are 111 deaths into the police custody, 330 cases of custodial torture, and 24,600 plus other complaints against the police. Now let's compare this particular data with the Australia. So guys, here we can find that according to the Australian Institute of Criminology, from 1989-90 to 2010-11, approximately 20-21 years, the death into the police custody has been just 700. Then guys, into the UK, England and Wales, it has been provided that the death in police custody or following contact with the police from 1990 to 2015, that is guys, nearly 25 years, there have been 1542 such incidents. So 25 years, 20 years, these many incidents have been there. And guys, now compare the cases that have come into the India in just 1 year or even less than 1 year, more than 25,000. So guys, it shows that police is committing the excess onto the citizens many a times, and therefore their fundamental rights are being violated many a times by the police. Now guys, when we talk about the excesses by the police, it has been provided that there are the psychological reasons into this particular capacity, and it has been provided by two of the most famous experiments, that is the Stanford Prison Experiment and the Milgram Experiment. Now let's see that what these experiments were. First of all guys, under the Stanford Prison Experiment, the inmates, they were divided into the two groups. One were made as the police guards and other were kept as the inmates. Into the mean course of time, it was seen that the prisoners who were performing the role of prison guards, they started to torture the inmates. They started to commit the violence against the inmates. Fine. Now this particular thing was seen here. Then guys, the next comes is the Milgram experiment. Into the Milgram experiment also, a kind of a social experiment was done, where it was said to some of the people that they need to ask some questions onto the other questions or other people, and if these people are giving the wrong answer, then they need to administer them the current. You're getting? So they will ask the question with the other people. If they give the wrong answer, then the current will be administered. Now guys, actually the people who were being asked the questions, they were the actors, or they were the people who were from the side of experimenters also. And actually they were not to receive any kind of shock. They were just acting that they are receiving the shock. Now guys, these people, they were said that not only they need to give the current or the shock when they are giving the wrong answer, rather at every instance, the level of shock also needs to be increased. Now guys, into the mean course of time, these people who were the part from the experimenters team, they deliberately gave the wrong answer. Now these people, they started to increase the shock. And guys, in mean course of time, it was seen that they were giving much more than the shock which a person can tolerate. Now into this capacity guys, the people who were asking the question and giving the shock, we see that they have forgotten the sense of rationality. So here the conclusion was made that whenever you give an authority to a person, into that authority, okay, into that obedience, he becomes blind. And guys, when a kind of a coercion or a kind of a pressure also comes with the obedience, then the person becomes even more blind. Now bringing all these conclusions into the Indian conditions, so guys, into the India, what has happened? Number one, there are the police officers at the level of constables or at the lower levels into the hierarchy. Often they are given the basically kind of a very clear-cut orders by the superiors. Moreover, superiors not only give them the order, rather an element of coercion is also there onto the junior level police officers. And into this capacity, just to follow the order, they forget all kind of rationality, and just to achieve some of the kind of concrete results onto the ground, whatever they have at their disposal, they'll use it. They'll use the force, they will use the torture, they'll use the violence and all such kind of things. And into this capacity, all the time there will be the instances that will happen at the police that the people will be died into the custody and all such kind of things. Now guys, it has been provided that first of all, such kind of behavior is also coming from the colonial mindset which is there into the Indian police. When we talk about the Indian police, it has been raised during the time of the Britishers. Basically, the Police Act of 1861 lays the structure or the foundation of the Indian policing. Now, during the time of 1857, 1860s, what was the mindset? Mindset of the Britishers were to introduce a kind of a force which could discipline the people, which could keep the nationalistic sentiments at bay. And into that capacity, never the police as a service was envisaged. Now guys, we got independent, but we did not check such kind of things. And even till today, that mindset of coercion, mindset of authority is still going on. So we need to bring the substantial reforms which makes the policing more humane, more good, more responsible. Now guys, many countries, they have also suggested that the privatization of the prisons can also be done. Into the USA, already such kind of thing has happened, but guys, it has not been very good onto the ground of providing justice to the citizens. So guys, into the India also, rather than going for the privatization of prisons, the state-sponsored state-sponsored reforms into the prisons are to be introduced, which makes the policing more humane. So that is all the message that has been given into this particular article. Guys, the Milgram experiment which I suggested, if you have understood it, well and good. If not, then guys, no problem. It is not the part of the original, this editorial. Just for the clarity, we had taken it up. So even if it is not clear, you don't need to sweat over on it. So that is all about this article. And now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article has given some suggestions that how India can be made as a sporting nation. Now guys, when we talk about the India's performance at the Olympics as well as many other kind of sporting events has not been very much good. Now, first of all, whenever the performance of any country on any of the sporting event is seen, then guys, there was earlier the econometrics that were used. Now guys, econometrics, they say that any country's potential to win the medals is very much linked to their GDP. It was said that the total GDP is the best predictor of the national Olympic performance. Moreover, it was also said that any of the country which is the host, it is likely to win additional 1.8% of the medals beyond what will be predicted by their GDP. So the economic progress, the GDP, they were made as the parameters of a country's performance into the Olympic. Now guys, these econometrics, they are not right now. Okay, why? Because guys, we have seen the performance of many of the countries, particularly the countries from the Caribbean, the countries or the Caribbean nations. Into the Caribbean nations, they have won so much of the medals, but their GDP is not very much good. In contrast, there are the countries with far bigger GDP, their performance has not been good. When we talk about the countries into the South Asia, Southeast Asia, we have such big countries whose GDP is so much big, but still the tally into the Olympics is not that much good. So the econometrics in predicting the sporting performance is not good. Rather, what are the factors which determine a country's performance? Number one factor is the guys, the condition, the standard of living into one particular country. Wherever the standard of living will be good, automatically the good nutrition, good health will be there. Wherever the standard of living will be poor, there will be the malnutrition, undernutrition, poverty, hunger, and into such kind of instances, the sporting cannot be followed. So this is number one. Then guys, number two, it has been provided that even the GDP can hardly be important into the countries like India, where a sizable segment is fighting the hunger. Then guys, the next, it has been provided that the genetic factors are very much important, because it has been seen, for example, the USA, Australia and Netherlands, they are very much good into the swimming. Why? Because the people here are tall, and because of that thing, they get a comparative advantage. China is not very much good into the swimming because of the heights of the Chinese people. Then guys, into the same capacity, it has been provided that Russia, East European nation and Central European countries, they do well in amateur boxing, whereas China and Central Asia countries do better in weightlifting and wrestling. So genetics play also an important role. So these are the observations that have been made here. Now guys, further, it has been provided that when we talk about the India's performance into the sporting, India has been at a kind of a good ground into the start, because the Britishers, they took some of the efforts to introduce the sporting into the India, and because of the Britishers' effort, guys, we see that the Calcutta Football League was already there into the India. Now the Calcutta Football League, it is the oldest football league into the Asia. Then guys, the Durand Cup, it was there, and the Durand Cup is the oldest existing football tournament into the Asia. So into the Asia, India had a first mover advantage, but this particular advantage has not been reaped by India after the independence because of the scarcity of resources, because of the less attention that was given by the government. Then guys, further it has also been provided that when we see about the India, we find that India is moderately good at many sports, but not good enough or to be the best at any of them. Now when we talk about the Jamaica does very good into the sprinting, and much of the medals they are winning into the sprinting. Then when we talk about the Kenya, they get the medals into the long distance running. So guys, these are the countries which have developed a specific niche. For example, the USA, they have developed a specific niche. This was some of the specific niches. Swimming is one of them. So India also needs to focus into this capacity. So guys, now bringing all these particular things into the perspective, see, number one, we see that India is a country which is having so many of the states. Now into these different states, different genetics are there into the people. Now they have the different genetics, plus they also have the distinct food habits. Now taking the particular genetics, we can identify that one particular state should specialize in one particular sport, and into that capacity they should train their youth so that they can represent the India at the sporting events such as the Olympics. Now guys, when we will be training one particular state in one particular sport, a kind of a specialization will come. We have seen that Kenya is doing good only into the one segment. So into this segment, guys, so many of the segments we can develop at the end of the day. Moreover guys, when a specific sport is to be developed, states can give dedicated focus, dedicated attention, and dedicated infrastructure can also be provided. So therefore, one state, one sport can be a game changer for the India, and into this capacity we should explore. So guys, this is the entire idea that has been given into this particular article. I hope you have understood it, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article is talking that how the geopolitical changes are coming within the Egypt, and how it will be changing the affairs at the West Asian level, how the Egyptian politics, Egyptian economy, and other aspect into the Egypt will be going under a kind of a change. Now guys, into this particular article, specific implication with respect to the India has not been there, and because of that thing, there is not very much substance into this particular article with respect to our examination. However guys, if you are a political science students, and if you have a particular interest into the region, you can read it, but very much importance with respect to the general studies has not been there. So just that is, if you want, you can read it, otherwise you can skip it. So that is all. Now we'll move to the next article. Now guys, this particular article, it is talking about the fundamental right of the speedy trial. Now what has happened? The Bombay High Court has specifically said that the speedy trial is a fundamental right under the article number 21. Bombay High Court has provided that the people who are languishing into the prison and waiting for their trial to begin, their fundamental right is being breached. Today we see so many of the under trials are there into the jail, and they are simply languishing. So their rights is needed to be preserved. Now earlier also, apart from the Bombay High Court, Supreme Court has also observed that the right to speedy trial is a part of a fundamental right. Guys, here we can see that first of all, there is the Kartar Singh versus State of Punjab case, which came into the 1961. Here the Supreme Court said that the speedy trial is an essential part of the article number 21. Then guys, the next was into the 1979, into the Husnaira Khatun versus Home Secretary of the State of Bihar also, the Supreme Court has observed that right to speedy trial is a fundamental right, and it is implicit into the right to life under article number 21. Then guys, after that, into the Sheila Barsa versus Union of India case in 1986 also, the right to speedy trial was also observed as being a fundamental right. Then guys, other cases, the Abdul Rahman Atule versus R.S. Nayak case of 1992, where again right to speedy trial as a part of article 21 was taken up. And then guys, finally there is the Ram Chandra Rao versus State of Karnataka, where again it was held that the section 309, 311 and 258 of Code of Criminal Procedure provides that the right to speedy trial will be given to the people. So guys, these are all the provisions or the judgments with respect to the right to speedy trial. So guys, please do utilize them into your answers if a question is coming. And now the Bombay High Court has also talked about it. Now guys, Bombay High Court is observing that many a times the activists are being lodged into the jail, sometime under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, sometimes under the Sedition and other under many other legislations also. So such kind of thing should not be there. If they are actually guilty or if they have actually committed such kind of thing, trial should begin and trial should be concluded also as early as possible. So this is all about this particular article. Fine. So this is all, and now we'll move to the next article. Now guys, this particular article talks about the new Oxfam report, fine, which has highlighted the inequalities that are existing in India. And guys, these inequalities are actually existing on some of the predictable patterns. Now first of all, India Inequality Report 2021 has been published, fine, and the name of our report is India's Unequal Health Story. It provides that number one, general category is better off than the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. Hindus are better than the Muslims and the rich are better than the poor. And guys, then when we talk about the gender, then the men are better than the women. And when we talk about the region, the urban population is better than the rural population on many of the health determinants. Now guys, it has been provided that this particular study, it is based on to the data from the round 3 and round 4 from the National Family Health Survey, as well as from the various other rounds of the National Sample Survey. So National Family Health Survey's 5th report, guys, will now be published. Already the interim report from the National Family Health Survey 5 has already been there, which covered the 20 states and union territories, but for the others it will also be coming out. So the NFHS has been used. Now guys, it has been provided here that when we talk about the women's literacy, it has improved, but guys, the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe women, they still lag behind the general category women. Now the scheduled caste are 18.6% behind and the scheduled tribe, they are 27.9% behind. Fine, so the improvement into the women is good, but within the SC and ST it is not there. Then guys, it has been provided that when we talk about the sanitation, fine, so onto the ground of sanitation, 65.7% of the households, they have access to improved non-shared facilities for the sanitation, but the SC households are 28.5% behind and ST are 39.8% behind when we compared with the general people. Then guys, it has also been provided that the institutional deliveries in India has increased from 38.7% in 2005-06 to 78.9%. But inequalities are persisting within the scheduled tribes, scheduled caste, Hindu, Muslims. Now, we can see that into the scheduled tribe, there are 15% less institutional deliveries that are happening when we compare it to the general category. In Muslims, they are 12% behind the Hindus and 35% gap is there between the poor and the rich. Fine. So guys, these are some of the good data that have been there and you can utilize them into the GS paper number 2 under the answers related to the social justice, because many times such inequalities are to be talked and there you need the data. So guys, please do keep such kind of data into your mind. You don't need to keep all the percentage figures, but guys, just who is better, who is poor, you need to keep, and the reference of the report will be doing good here. So that is all. Now we'll move to the next article. Now guys, this particular article talks about protecting the children, which happens to be the priority of the state. Now guys, what happened into the pandemic, there are so many of the children who had become orphan, and as the children had become orphan, the judiciary had many a times asked the government that they need to tell that what they are doing for the children who had become orphan. Now guys, here, now what had done, the Ministry of Women and Child Development had said that in order to protect the children who had become orphan into the pandemic, or the other children also who are been into the distress, the specific responsibility under the Juvenile Justice Act of 2015 has been identified. Now guys, when we talk about the Juvenile Justice Act, it provides the safety nets for the children, it provides the institutional and non-institutional care, the protection of the children who are into the need of care, fine, as well as the children who are into the conflict of law. So it has been provided that the responsibility with respect to the implementation of the Juvenile Justice Act is there onto the state as well as onto the union territories. We will coordinate with the state and union territories so that the relief under the JJ Act will be given. Then guys, next it has been provided. Now this is the extra that we are taking up. So guys, few days back we have seen that the government also came out with the comprehensive fiscal aid package for the children. So this also you can utilize if a question is coming. Now under this comprehensive fiscal aid package that has been given by the government had said that the student will be enrolled into the Kendriya Vidyalaya or the private school. Fine, who had become orphan. Then student of 11 to 8 years, they can be enrolled into the Sainik schools or the Navodaya Vidyalaya also. The health insurance cover of 5 lakh rupees will be given. Corpus of 10 lakh rupees per child will also be created. And monthly stipend will be offered from this corpus of 10 lakh rupees to the children when they attain the age of 18 years. And guys, the lump sum money of that 10 lakh rupees which will be created, they will be provided to the children after they will attain the age of 23. So this is some of the efforts that have been taken up. Fine. So guys, keep it into your mind, and if a question is there, you can cite the reforms that have been taken by the government. So that is all about this particular article, and now we'll move to the next article. Now guys, this particular article talks about convening the labor conference which is due here. Now when we talk about the labor conference, guys, here it has been provided that the Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh, it is saying that the Indian labor conference, its session is pending from 2015. Now guys, when we talk about the Indian labor conference, it is a kind of a triple tight conference. Here the representatives of government come, from the employees come, and from the employers come, and they look into the impact, into the problems that are there with the laborers, fine, with the employees. So since 2015 the session has not happened. Now guys, earlier it used to happen at the gap of 1 year or at maximum 2 years, but now it is not there. So guys, to convene the labor conference, the appeal has been made to the government. Now guys, why it is needed? Number one, to ensure the well-being of our laborers. Secondly, that India has signed the convention number 144 under the ILO, and the convention 144 talks about the tripartism. It means that from time to time government needs to take the effort that these three parties, that is the government, employees and employers, they are coming together and they are looking into the problems of the labor people. So into this capacity, government need to follow its mandate. Fine. Now guys, when we talk about the ILO, it was established in 1919 after the Treaty of Versailles, and it became the first affiliated special agency under the United Nations in 1946. Now the headquarters of the ILO is into the Geneva, Switzerland. And guys, it also received the Nobel Peace Prize in 1969, and it aims to provide the social justice to the people. So particularly the labor class people. So that is all about this particular article, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article just talking about some of the projections with respect to the Indian economy. So it has been provided that the Indian economy is on the course of development, and 11% growth will be seen into this particular fiscal year. Moreover, the fiscal deficit target will also be reached. It has been said that the 6.8% fiscal deficit will be there. And guys, it has been said that the capital spending will be increased by 35% into this particular year, and it was said into the budget. And when this capital spending will be increased, we will see that the jobs will increase. Is it clear? When this capital spending will increase, money will go to the people, and the aggregate demand will also increase into the economy. However, inflation, the next waves of the COVID might be the problem into this thing, for which the government needs to be careful. So such kind of message has been given. However guys, apart from this, nothing very much important into this particular article. So that is all guys, I hope that you have understood it, and guys, I believe that you are finding the utility into our newspaper analysis. So that is all for today. Thank you so much.